Good morning, and welcome to another magnificent sunrise. You can see there the fires of the day have just been lit in the eastern horizon. You are on a live sunset sunrise safari. My name is James, and this is Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
So the sun has yet to peep up over the horizon. It's probably about 10 or 20 minutes off doing that. It's a glorious morning, very chilly here in the northeast corner of the world's most beautiful country. 9 degrees Celsius, I'm told, 48 degrees Fahrenheit. This I believe to be a foul and contemptible untruth. I think it is probably where I'm sitting, down in the lower reaches, right near the valley of the great Mlo-Amati drainage line. I'd say we're probably sitting at about maybe 6 degrees Celsius, so about 42 degrees Fahrenheit, I think that is. My name is James Henry. Like I said, on camera today we have Eggsy. Hello, Eggsy.
Hi.
There's Eggsy, everybody. Eggsy is... produced a very beautiful picture for you there. On the other vehicle, the inimitable Brent Leo Smith is being filmed by Brian Joubert. We have to redo the shock absorbers in that car when they go out, of course, both being very vast human beings. And then on foot today, Jamie Patterson, and she's going to be elegantly traipsing around the bush looking for the small things on her walk, and possibly some bigger things, and she's being filmed, I think, by Wim Doren Braak, he of the Paul Krugerish nature, no?
Genre.
Eggsy was shaking his head there. I'll have to have a word with him about that. And obviously, Stefan, the mystic boer, will be operating on security detail there. So that's the team for the morning. Also, a very important part of the team, of course, the final control of Kirsten McLennan-Smith, and I think Geraldine the Cheesecake Kent, who's also there. So that is the team. Our plan now, I'm not going to go through the chefs and that sort of thing. We'll do that later if you like. Our plan is to head off east towards Cheetah Plains this morning. Brent's looking for the lions that many of you heard around the lodge sometime last night. I mean, I think the last call was probably about 10 minutes before we came live. So with any luck, his bloodhound-esque nose and sharp eagle-like eyes will find the cats for you. Aubrey and Taxon will be around that area, I've no doubt, fairly soon, so they'll give him a bit of a hand. We'll go to Cheetah Plains and see what we can find there. I forgot to tell you, we are live, like I did say three times, but you must please talk to us. It's very important. Hashtag Safari Live if you're on Twitter, or questions at wildearth.tv if you would rather talk to us on the email. That is all the things that I need to tell you. So we're going to continue going into the sunrise and with another view of this very sunrise, Mr. Brent Leo Smith.
Welcome to an absolutely gorgeous pre-dawn, and there's nothing quite like the silhouette of a Balanites morgamai, the torchwood, to start your day. But even better than that, if you look carefully at those clouds, they're actually very highly mobile. Now, here we go. If we look carefully, we can tell you for a fact the wind up there is going from north to south. Very, very few clouds, but and there's almost zero wind on the ground. But if we watch those clouds and the shape of those clouds, the wind is howling at about 500 meters above. And there we go, one of my favorite calls. And on bushwalk, I was lucky enough to have that bird with VM yesterday. And it's the Shelley's Franklin. To drink a beer. But on a more exciting note, I'm Brent Leo Smith, and I have Brian Joubert and the thumb controlling the camera. And together, sometimes, people whisper in the corners. And they say the killer bees are out. And the killer bees aim to show you the most incredible wildlife from the African bush today. And that is our plan. We're looking for lions, but anything that might come upon us, we shall definitely delve into in the most in-depth way possible. So it's really exciting to have you on this live African safari. The thumb, who actually controls Brian, and myself, Brent, are very excited to take you on the most immense, immersive wildlife experience in the world. So let's go look for some animals. So, through the night, the lions have been roaring in this general area. I'm just checking the northern boundary. I'm quite confident they're in Juma, but one must not count one's chickens before they hatch. So I'm making sure there are no tracks on the road. As you can see, it's quite dark, but I'm not using a spotlight because I ate all my carrots yesterday, so I can see well around me. The only reason I've got lights on to see if there are any lion tracks on the road. But I'm hoping the lions are around the general area where they were last night. Who knows, maybe they made a kill. Maybe some poor buffalo bull had to sacrifice himself to the feast of the lions. But I don't think so. I heard them roaring, but I didn't hear any kill sounds last night. And of course, it's quite difficult to mistake the sound of a dying buffalo. I have to take my gloves off for this. If you're going to do a proper buffalo distress call, one must take one's gloves off because you need to rub your hands together so they're warm. The sound seems to work better that way. I did not hear any of that last night, but we're hoping to hear it this morning, which will lead us straight to the lions. Now I've got to put my gloves back on because it's cold. Now, of course, you might have noticed that I have my one big fluffy mitt. But again, the mitt monster has hidden my other mitt. So I stole one of Jamie's this morning. And it does look a little ridiculous. I must admit, I take my hats off to Jamie because this is not a warm mitt. This is a very thin mitt. This is a warm mitt. This is a cold mitt. But it's better than no mitt. Okay, so in this little dip here, in this general area, if we watch my fat mitt, there is where I think the lions are from the last roar I heard this morning. And there, that roar for me, now I'm still in my, actually my, probably my 33rd year of studying lion roars. I haven't quite worked out the dialects yet, but I'm getting there. I don't think I'll ever get there as such, but I think that the roars we were hearing through the night and this morning were dominant roars. It was, whose land is it? Mine. Not, where are you roars? So I think they were proclaiming, because from here it's not very far to the Manuleti. As the crow flies, it's probably about 4 kilometers. And just to the north of the Manuleti is where there is another coalition of male lions. So I think they were just making themselves well known that they are dominant, large and in charge and in the area. But while we continue to look for the largest carnivore in Africa, let's go back to James, who's got one of the smaller, sweeter creatures in the bush.
Two Duiker, everybody, probably a mating pair, and they are sitting underneath one of the most magnificent trees at Juma, and this magnificent tree has now provided me with my third exceptional sighting. It is dropping its little jackalberries onto the ground there, and the Duiker are thoroughly pleased with this development. They don't have to eat tannin infused leaves this morning. They can feed on some lovely sweet fruits dropped by the monkeys and birds that have been devouring the hanging bulbs in the tree there. We don't often get to view them like this, you know. They so seldom will stand still. They're very aware of us, but we are probably about 80 meters from them. What is that in feet? About 200 feet or so. No, about 260 feet odd. And so they're just quite relaxed. They will definitely move as we go closer to them. So that tree, I mean, I don't remember jackalberries fruiting at this time of the year. That tree's attempted to fruit twice. It did a sort of brief and fairly poor attempt somewhere around probably February or March, maybe, and it dropped a couple of very unsweet fruits. Now, at the end of this very long dry season, with another sort of 2 months to go, possibly, of extremely dry weather, it's produced a massive load of berries. And there go the Duiker, everyone. This is Twin Dams. We're about to turn onto the main road to the east towards Cheetah Plains. It's a very nice sighting to start with, Eggsy, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes, it is. Now, I haven't seen any tracks on the road, which is a good thing, especially for Brent's lion hunt, because we're now sort of turning from, you know, down the south, or where I've completely lost my mind. We are turning to the east from the southern, along the southern boundary, that's what I wanted to say, and there are no lion tracks thus far, which means that the lion hunting up north is probably still a good idea, because often those lions come past here, they roar at the pan, and then they walk down south, beyond which we are unable to follow them. And Chris Rogue, you said you heard zebra distress calls this night and also the Nkuhumas calling. Well, I think it's quite possible that something is killed somewhere around where Brent is. They could either be sort of between Mvubu Road and the Gallagher shortcut, Gowrie cut line, which is not too difficult to get into in a car. They could also be between Gallagher shortcut and Mvubu Road, which is a very, very difficult block. And if they've killed something in there, well, then they're going to be difficult to find. But certainly, zebra distress calls and the lack of calling this morning, and the fact that the males went quiet pretty early, indicates that perhaps, yeah, Chris, maybe they did kill inside the block there. Maybe the males have just discovered them, and they, instead of shouting their territory, are now enjoying a very nice breakfast. We are now going to go into the very coldest part of the reserve. Hello, Michael. We're going to Cheetah Plains, and you say you'd like to see Mr. Q, I think you said, this morning. That is quarantine male leopard, for those who don't know. He's almost 4 years old now. Well, he's about 3.5, actually. We're now in the coldest position at Juma, and that's simply because it's the lowest down. The valley of the great Mluamati crosses out to the south. Michael, I would very much like to see Mr. Q today. I haven't seen him for a great deal of time. Also, of course, one of his greatest fans is Hayden Turner, who unfortunately leaves us today after his brief stint. It's been wonderful having him. Ooh. All right, we're going to head a little bit quicker now towards Cheetah Plains. We'll see you on the other side. Sorry, you're going to Brent now.
So we're going really slowly at the moment. It's still difficult to see tracks in this light, so we don't want to miss any tracks. And we know about Chris Rogue's update about lions and zebra distress calls. So not only am I looking for lion tracks, I'm looking for the pounding hooves of a horse wearing pajamas. But so far, the only tracks I see are of cars, but I am looking very carefully. And I'm hoping that the lion's roar breaks the dawn. Good morrow, Andrew, and welcome on this incredible live sunrise safari. Andrew is wondering, what is my favorite lion? Ooh, Andrew. Now, I do love a male lion, I don't know, just if they're not doing anything, they're not that interesting. Now, fat, flatulent, and sleeping cats. I think out of all the lions we see regularly, my favorite lion is the amber-eyed lioness of the Nkoma pride. Now, my favorite lion of all time, on the other hand, is a male, but he was less flat and flatulent than other male lions I've spent time with. And it was a part of a coalition of four that we used to have in northern Botswana. I think whatever happened to him in his youth, the hyenas must have harassed them a lot. He had the utmost hate for hyenas. And I've never, to this day, seen another lion like that. And literally, he would see a hyena 600 meters away and he would stalk him. The one night, he killed five hyenas in a row. Literally, we came out, we found his tracks, we started following his tracks down the road. Dead hyena. Another 400 meters. Dead hyena. Another 500-600 meters, dead hyena. There were four dead hyenas down the road. And if a hyena popped up, if they were on a buffalo kill or a giraffe kill, and a hyena would pop out 900 meters away, he would leave eating and start stalking that hyena. It was absolutely incredible. So the only thing I can think is he must have been harassed immensely by hyenas while he was young. But I think that was my favorite lion of all time. He didn't even have a name. We didn't really name animals up in Botswana too much. And the thing is, we were lucky enough, we were in the most massive concession. Probably the largest private concession in Africa. It was 232,000 hectares, so over 500,000 acres. And we only had 3 cars in that whole area. And it was not uncommon to see a lion you'd never seen before, or a leopard, or a pack of wild dogs. So I think, I was trying to remember the stats on that turn of the, I think it was, I can't remember all the facts now. But it was massive, put it that way. Still think probably one of my favorite places in Africa. 80 kilometers along the Kwando River. So we're on Mvubu Road, and we are checking. So far, there have been no tracks. I'm going very, very slowly. What I'm hoping is, by keeping the revs very low and just idling along in first gear, is that if they do roar, I'll be able to hear it over the engine. But as we know, or as I harp on about, your ears find animals far more often than your eyes do. So what we're going to do is we're going to use our ears. I'm just going to get to that little bump in the road there, and we're going to sneak stealthily and freewheel from here till we can't anymore. But we are very lucky today, because while we might not hear everything because we're on a car and we've got the car engines to deal with, we have Jamie out on bushwalk. So while you're walking, you're able to hear a lot more. So let's go say good morning to Jamie and see if she's heard anything while I've been waffling away.
Good morning and welcome to our version of the Sunrise Safari as we head out on foot. My name is Jamie and I have Jandre on camera with me. And this morning we have Steph on security detail, who was telling us something. Sorry, Steph, what was that? Oh, very nice. There is a bearded woodpecker. Yes, there he is. Can hear it, can't see him, but it's going to. So the lovely thing about being out on foot is that you do, as Brent suggested, get to hear and to see things that you might not necessarily spot from the vehicle, and that's what makes walking out here so fun. And I have to say, as much as I love being on the vehicle, being out on foot is probably my favourite way to experience the bush. Somewhere off in the eastern direction is a male lion roaring his territorial outcry, battle cry, first thing in the morning. And of course, we had that dramatic scene yesterday of the Birmingham boys fighting each other and the Nkuhuma lionesses, probably over a female that's in estrus. Sorry, just having a look at this hole. That is freshly excavated. That's been cleared out by something. And in this case, just judging by the tracks, the tracks are just little dots in the sand. This was probably made by a creature called a bushveld gerbil. Now what I'm not going to do is stick my hand right into the hole, obviously. That's the last thing you want to do out here. Because these bushveld gerbil holes make perfect spots for a...
Well, it looks like... I'm not sure whether it's an elephant. It is an elephant. There's a patch of sand there that looks like it could have been a big cat lying, but it is actually just an elephant dragging its foot. Naughty elephant. I'm trying to look for lions. Of course, today is World Elephant Day. Yay for elephants! So, like World Lion Day, I think I am going to do some elephant quizzes today. And if we have no success with the lions, I shall only be searching for elephants afterwards. And I think the first quiz for World Elephant Day. Aha! What area in Africa has the largest body-sized elephants? Now, what area in Africa has the largest body-sized elephant? That means not the biggest teeth, not the biggest tusks, but the tallest at the shoulder and the heaviest elephants in Africa. And it's quite a tricky one, and it's a very interesting one. So I'm hoping someone will get it. If not, I will have managed to teach you something. And I'm not going to say where or near what it is, but what area in Africa has the largest body-sized elephants at the moment? And there's quite a lot of research being done on them. So if you know the answer to where are the tallest and heaviest elephants in Africa, send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or #SafariLive on Twitter. Now, I'm quite confident, because it's World Elephant Day, that we'll hopefully be inundated with elephants, and maybe even we'll have lions that are being chased by elephants. One never knows. Okay, so I'm a little worried. I haven't seen a lion track yet, and I don't think I've missed any tracks. Could they have caught the zebra that Chris Rogue heard in distress somewhere in this block? Oh, James Richard says, "Happy World Elephant Day to all the elephants." I agree. All elephants are absolutely wonderful and as important as each other. Okay, come on, kitty cats. Or heffalumps, where are you hiding? So the first answer for the elephant, the first of the Elephant Day quizzes is Botswana. It's not Botswana. Botswana does have very large-bodied elephants, not famous for large tusks, but famous for being large-bodied, but not the largest in Africa. And as you can see, I'm still sipping on my tea. Now the next answer is it Central Africa? It's not. Now Central Africa is quite interesting because it's a sort of a crossover section. And strangely enough, just before I happened to join Safari Live, I nearly ended up moving to Central Africa. So there's a very interesting story there in that. So Central Africa is in the centre of Africa, ha 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 ha, but it has crossover elephants. So to the west of Central Africa, and even in the western parts of Central Africa, you have forest elephants. Now, forest elephants are a lot smaller. A big bull weighing about 3,500 kilograms, so about the same size as an elephant cow here. And a big savannah elephant in this area weighs probably 5,500 kilos to 2-7. Seven would be an abnormally large individual.
Brent's coming for Steph.
Oh, Steph's calling me. And we do apologize. This little boxy thing is playing up, so you have to listen to us talk. Standing by.
We just got audio of a Singoma lion vocalizing from behind Gallagher, just north of Gallagher camp. It sounds like either at the pan or on that game path, that big game path that goes north away from the pan.
Copy, thanks very much, Steph. As soon as Gallagher is out on drive, I'll go check.
Joe, it didn't sound...
Okay, so as we were talking about...
Maybe just north of there, but somewhere on...
The different... Oh no, is it not on here? Oh, there's one at least. A forest elephante. So, if we look at a forest elephant's tusks, see how they go. This is a particularly beautiful bull, and I was lucky enough to spend quite a lot of time with Gabon. Their tusks go straight down, their head shape slightly different, and their body size is minute. What I'll do is, because it's World Elephant Day, I'll find a picture of a forest elephant with some form of reference, and I'll find a picture of a savannah elephant, and I'll put them next to each other, and I'll post them later today so you guys can have a look. So, what about Central Africa? So, as you come east in Central Africa, you get to probably one of the most interesting areas in the world, and that's where we were supposed to go work, but unfortunately the political climate and change in the country, and it's not a very safe place at the moment. So, there you have elephants that look half like savannah elephants and half like forest elephants. But if you go further to the east, they turn into proper savannah elephants. Now, for a long time, forest elephants were considered to be a completely separate species. Now, a completely separate species is not able to mate to produce viable offspring, whereas forest elephants and savannah elephants are able to. And that's why you have hybrids, the wrong word, but it's a word I'm going to use for now. It's not a hybrid. It's just an in-betweener. And these elephants completely cross over and mate. Now, the reason the forest elephant is much smaller and the tusks face down as opposed to curving upward, it's because of their habitat. I mean, he's out in a marsh at the moment, but that is literally what it looks like in that forest. It is so thick. And often when we were walking on foot there, we used to see them at like 5 meters before you even knew the elephant was there. So the tusks face down so it doesn't catch in all the lianas and thickets and vines that are out in that forest. So, and the Latin name for, or scientific name for a forest elephant is Loxodonta africana cyclotis. And their eyes are very, 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 very cool. And they're almost golden. They're much more striking than the normal savannah elephants. I will try find a picture of that later on drive. But Aubrey's out, which means we can go check behind Gallagher camp.
Somewhere on Gallagher shortcut, perhaps, or that game path.
Oh, there we go. But I think I might have stumped you guys. And if I manage to stump you 2 days in a row, I think Brian will give me a pat on the back. Because you couldn't get the Waltharia yesterday, the little flower, the only flower. Oh, there were two flowers on quarantine, but one of the only two flowers at the moment. Oh my goodness, my hand is missing my mitt. Well, next answers in is Tanzania or Kenya, and again, not correct. I think I'm going to do a little... I stumped you dance shortly, but maybe I should, a little hint, it's a bit further south. Or was that making it too easy, Brian? Oh, I don't know. But, I'm going to let you stew in your thoughts to try to figure out what area in Africa has the largest body size, the tallest and heaviest elephant. And while you think about that, James has got a bird that looks like it belongs in Jurassic Park.
I'm not sure it looks like it belongs in Jurassic Park, but it is certainly slightly sort of otherworldly. The helmeted guinea fowl fluttering about there, a little flock of them. I think they're rather amusing to watch. They look very surprised by life and somewhat incongruous. They look totally immobile. And again, on the theme of the Olympics, of course, we know that Michael Johnson, still the record holder for the 400 metres, in about 43.18 seconds, I think, was his time. The humble guinea fowl at which you're looking now will do the 400 metres in roughly 35 seconds. And I've always wanted to meet Michael Johnson so that I might ask him if he'd care to race a guinea fowl around the 400 metres and see which one would win. I think it'd be quite amusing to see them coming down the home straight, the humble guinea fowl streaming ahead, clucking away. They really are the chickens of the bush. As Brent has said to you, World Elephant Day, and yesterday, of course, we saw thousands of elephants. When it was World Elephant Day, probably in Fiji by that stage, I had a suspicion today that there wouldn't be an elephant or an elephant track. Indeed, that has proved to be the case. I have seen not hide nor hair of an elephant here on World Elephant Day, but with any luck, we'll be lucky to see some and bid them well on this their very own day. I wonder if there's a World Egg Day, Eggsy.
Breakfast.
See an ostrich, not an Australian. You see plenty of those every day. You'd like to see an ostrich. And, well, the thing is, Joey, that I'm actually in Cheetah Plains to do the same thing, to find an ostrich. And I'm hoping to enlist a technique that Hayden Turner showed me the other day. And it's an Australian technique for attracting emus. I'm going to attempt that. If we see the ostriches, I'm going to attempt the very same thing in the clearings. Now, I'm not going to tell you what it is. I'll leave that as a sort of fairly disturbing surprise a little bit later in the day. So, Joey, I'll do my best to find and then attract the ostriches. I'm going to just go backwards so that Eggsy might get an artistic shot of the sun coming up through the fork of that apple leaf tree. Eggsy, face the camera towards that great golden orb in the east. That's it. That's it. There. Oh. There. There. Okay. Zoom. I've really hashed that, haven't I? Sorry, everybody. But there is the sun coming up. It's quite nice because Brent and I were out probably a good half hour before any of the other vehicles were around, and it's very nice to just be sort of feel like you're the first out and be on the fresh roads, the fresh tracks. There are some elephant tracks, everybody. I'll see if I can find a distinct one to show you. Nothing. The radio is now going ballistic in my ear as everybody gets mobile, and that's an exciting part of the day. When I say everybody, I mean all the lodges around here, Cheetah Plains, Chitwa, and Koro, the Arethusa guys off to the west, the Juma guys at Juma. And it's all a kind of exciting period as we decide where we're going to go, what animals we're going to look for, etc., etc. Now, this elephant went that way. Let's carry on this way. Very nice one from Maralise, what predators chase guinea fowl? Just about anything will eat a guinea fowl, you know. Predators like leopards would certainly go for them. One of their major predators, interestingly, is caracal. Caracal quite like to eat guinea fowl, and they do these amazing leaps from the ground. You get photographers have got incredible pictures of caracals kind of in mid-air catching the guinea fowl flying off the ground. But also, you want to know if a hyena would bother. Yes, I think a hyena would certainly bother. I don't know that a hyena would bother to actually chase a guinea fowl, but certainly a hyena would bother to try and, you know, if it came across a dead one, it would definitely eat it. Or an unsuspecting one that wasn't watching where it was. Some monkeys tracks on the road. Gorgeous morning here. You can just see how the golden light is now touching this knobthorn. And now, Exie, when I point at a tree, it's very important that you show the viewers what I'm looking at, although they will think I'm mad. Eggsy's looking very disconcerted, everybody. He's very unhappy with me for telling him how to do his job. bad news on the bushwalk front, I'm afraid, everybody. It seems that Pajamas Patterson is having no more luck than I had yesterday with the morning bushwalk, so they've headed back to the DRC. Which is where we live. And Anna Marie, you would like to see some jackals here? Well, we'd hopefully see them too. I'd quite like to see some jackals. So we'll go with jackals, ostrich, quarantine male leopard, and some elephants just to round off World Elephant Day. I think it's a good idea. But I'm looking forward to getting into those clearings and bathing myself in the sun. For I tell you, it has been a very chilly little drive over here. Eggsy can't feel his face, but that could be on account of the beard that he has. Eggsy, how long did it take you to grow your beard? Eggsy just said that he doesn't remember the last time he was clean shaven. I imagine underneath his beard he probably looks like he's about 12. But thank you, Lucy in South Bend, Indiana. You say World Egg Day is on September the 14th, is that correct? October the 14th. Right, Eggsy will be certain to celebrate your special day on the 14th of October. That's wonderful. We'll go past the three in a row pan first. Often you find lions in the middle of the morning or early morning, they like to go and sit by the water there and shout their heads off. Not sure why that would be. It's not necessarily a good time for them to drink, but that's often what they do. And likewise, perhaps quarantine male leopard will be lurking around there in his favorite marula tree or on his favorite termite mound. Oh, it is very cold today. And a very sort of, it's a honeyed sunrise, no cloud there to sort of orange it up too much. We'll go straight in towards it now, Eggsy. We'll turn left here. I lost my mind, Eggsy. I do feel a bit lost, but we'll go this way anyway. I think I took a wrong turn. But I think we're okay because I can see the tower up ahead. I don't think we're trespassing. And the roads on Cheetah Plains are unbelievably manicured. You will hardly feel a bump. That's how I know I'm on Cheetah Plains. Okay, I'm going to try and figure out where I've gone wrong. Let's go back to Brent and find out how the lion tracking's going.
There are lions alive all around us, roaring. Aubrey's just found one on the boundary. We've heard another one, and I've got tracks of one going along here. So we're keeping a very close eye next to us, but we're going to shoot to the one that Aubrey's got, because it sounds like they're calling to each other. And it's the same one that Steph, or the same lions that Steph told me about calling earlier. Okay. I'm very excited. I think they're going to keep roaring. It's a cold morning, and I love the sound of a lion roar vibrating through my body, and the whole car seems to shake. It is one of the more special things. You see him? Brian's spotted a lion. I have not yet. Oh, there he is. That's the one we're tracking. Orbs has got it. Oh, no, it's the same one, I think. Look at him, big boy. Come on, give us a roar. Now, he's got a bit of a limp, and that's not unusual for a male lion. And on the sunrise safari yesterday with Jamie, you would have seen the toughness that the females showed towards the males, and the males show even far more aggression with each other. Hello, Hopalong. Oh, from one big cat to another big cat, we see even more seldom with James.
Look at that, everybody. Two male cheetahs mobile north. Marvelous, marvelous stuff. It's going to be difficult on the radio. I'm going to ask you to excuse my voice. Just enjoy watching them for now. Isn't that wonderful? Now, what I want you to notice, everyone, is that these cheetah are moving next to the road, completely unlike the leopard and completely unlike the lions. What they do is they don't walk on the road, they will walk next to the road. Isn't that beautiful? I'm just going to quickly talk on the radio again. Andrew, can I ask you to control the lineup? I can't hear properly on the radio. Copy. They're now reaching three in a row pan. Isn't this lovely, everybody? And the golden light there on them. I'm going to go a little bit closer, see if they sit on that. See that sit? If they sit on the termite mine, they're not going to. I'm going to move forward here. Stations, they're mobile north. Yes, mobile north. Now, let me see if I can get a rank average photograph of them, Eggsy. We are so lucky. We're not going to have long here because I think everyone will want to come in and see these cheetah. Here they come. How cool is this, everyone?
This is just brilliant stuff. Oh, wow. Let me just get out the way. Okay, everyone, we're not going to have very long here. There are thousands of people trying to come here. So we'll sit here for a little bit longer. Just move gently around the corner here. Everyone is so excited, everybody. Pretty sure they're going to go towards Nkoro now. And now marking territory. Cheetah, not the most territorial cats. And their scent doesn't last very long. And I think you'll find that there's one dominant male in this little coalition, and they're probably brothers. They're almost certainly brothers. Guys, we're going to have another 2 minutes with them, and then I'm afraid we're going to have to move out. Okay, I'm going to go past here. Nina, you say it's so nice that we're so close to the cheetah. It is just fantastic, isn't it? Station on standby for this cheetah sighting. Please make your way. I'll move out as soon as you hear. Ephraim. I'm just going to help Ephraim get in here.
Thanks.
Ephraim, make your way straight here. I'll move out as soon as you get here. I know it'd be nice to spend all morning with them, everyone, but because they're moving, they're going to probably walk off this reserve, which is going to be difficult for some of the others. So maybe we'll have just a few more minutes here, and then we'll have to carry on. Just going to move around. Wonderful question from somebody called Blobbit MacBlob. Blobbit, that is the best name on Twitter I've ever heard. I'm regularly astounded by the names people come up with for themselves. Brilliant, Blobbit MacBlob. You want to know if they respond or will mark on the markings of other big cats, these cheetahs? No, they won't. They will mark for other cheetahs. They won't mark over lions, for example. Oh, this is fantastic. Just trotting past us here. A little bit nervous. A little bit nervous there. I'm not sure why. So we'll just keep our distance. Gregory, you want to know how fast they can run? Well, Gregory, cheetah's the fastest land mammal, up to 100 kilometers per hour. This is going to be a nice shot for you, Eggsy. Isn't that nice? Ah, well, what cheetahs often do now. Hello, Hannah. You're just 9 and you're in South Africa. It's lovely to hear from you, someone from home. And you say, can you? We see a cheetah track? Yes, of course we can. We'll certainly try and find your cheetah track once these chaps move off. I don't think they're going to be here for long, but they might be. Isn't that beautiful? Ah, we are so lucky, everybody. Look at them in the perfect morning light. You couldn't really ask for a great deal more than we've got right now. And I'm just going to try and move around the other side. You know where Ephraim is? We're much luckier than I thought we were going to be with the timing here. Get him a little bit backlit now. Sherry in California, you want to know if these cheetah have got names. I don't think they do, other than Mr. Cheetah 1 and Mr. Cheetah 2, everybody. And that's because we don't see them all the time. And so, I'm sorry, the radio is a bit distracting in my mind here. I'm just going to quickly find out if from Andrew. Andrew? Is there someone waiting?
I can't get all of it right.
Okay. All right, do you think he heard me?
One, yeah.
Okay. Will you just... The next guy that wants to come, I'll book. Okay. Let's carry on, chaps. The other guys are not being particularly awake on the radio. I think actually we're going to go along the road because I think they're going to probably walk parallel with the road. Maybe they won't. We'll go into the block here. Oh, they're running. Look at them playing. They're playing there. Oh, they were very quick. Samantha, you want to know how I can tell the difference between male and female? Well, the males are slightly larger, but not obviously so like they are with leopards. But what you will find is that, they have very obvious sort of... Their male bits are very obvious behind the tail, and so you can see that very clearly and very obviously. Now, they won't even walk on this game path. This is an old game path here, so a path that elephants and other animals take towards the water. They always walk parallel, unlike the lions and the leopards. And Gail, of course, we do get asked this a few fairly regularly, where are the female cheetah? Well, we don't know really. I'm sure they come through here. This isn't the most optimal cheetah habitat in the world, which means that it's a little bit difficult for these guys to find ladies. But when ladies go into estrus, lady cheetah, they will come around this area, they will mark, and then these guys will pick up their presence. They tend to walk almost predictably between the big clearings in the south of Cheetah Plains, northern Mala Mala, and then up towards Biffle's Hook and into the Kruger, and then they come back down here. And on those wanderings, they'll mark their territory and they will smell the presence of females if they come in. I don't think I've seen a female cheetah here, though. Sorry, Avushek, I don't know what you... I'm just hang on one sec, I will answer your question. We're going to have to leave them, everybody. I think, well, we can go maybe just to the north of the road here. Avushek, I'm going to ask you a question again. Oh, Avushek, you want to know what happens when a male meets a female? Well, depends very much on whether she's in estrus or not, Avushek. So if she's in estrus, then they will probably mate. If not, they won't fight, but they'll avoid each other. So they're solitary, almost as solitary as leopards are, but not quite. So, I mean, you can see that the males will form these little coalitions. There they are. And you can maybe hear the impala behind us going, pff, pff, alarm calling. Thinking about trying to get onto that tree, you see that? There's impala, I've seen them from, I don't know, probably 300 meters away, and they're alarming from there. Okay, well, this is going to be our last view, everybody. We're going to pull out here. That's it, everyone, I'm afraid. Stations, I'm going to pull out of this sighting. We'll leave Andrew and Ephraim moving in with about a couple of others behind him. Oh! Marvellous. Marilis, I think you were asking about whether they have a common ancestor or not with leopards. Yes, they do. All the cats have got a common ancestor eventually. But I think that they split many, many years ago. I mean, much more recently, for example, than the common ancestor of lions and leopards, because they're in the same genus. These guys are genetically very different from leopards and lions. Okay, that's it, chaps. Oh, there's... what is that? There's something running down the road there. Oh. They flushed. I think it may have been a jackal. I can't go in there because the cheetahs are still there, but there was something that, there. It's jackals. It's two jackals. It's two jackals there that are running down through the clearings there. Yeah, that's what it was. All right, that's it, everyone. Brilliant. And you saw it. Well done, Eggsy. Good job. Something more to celebrate on the 14th of October. Radio is going absolutely ballistic. It's by far the best to just find them so that you don't have to get into a lineup of people trying to come in to see them. Eggsy, that's a pretty good start to Cheetah Plains, wouldn't you say? Yes, cheetahs are Cheetah Plains. That's how we roll. That is why they call it Cheetah Plains. Yes, Eggsy, well done. Watch your heads, everybody. Right, we'll now go to the clearings and find some ostriches. I hope. Alright, in the meantime, Jamie Patterson has managed to cajole and beat that bushwalk backpack into some kind of action. Let's go and find out what's happening with her.
Now, I'm not sure I had anything to do with the fixing of the bushwalk backpack. I'm not entirely sure how it was fixed, because somehow it was not working and now it's working again. So good morning once again. My name is Jamie and I have Jandre on camera with me, and hopefully we will have a little bit more of a walk now that things are working out. And what an amazing start you have had to the morning with two cheetah and then the male lion, which has been calling and is somewhere coming in this direction. I think that Steph, myself and Jandre are not actually going to go too far from quarantine, because I think there is a very good chance that that male lion is going to come popping out somewhere around here. One thing that you get very familiar with as you spend a bit more time in a certain area is you get familiar with the pathways that the animals use and the routes that they take. And there's a very large game path, and a game path is like an animal's hiking trail. They create their own paths, which is usually the easiest way through the bush. And it's like walking on a road. It's much easier, it's quieter, they don't run the risk of walking into any bushes or anything like that. And so they usually use the same path. And I'm looking past Jandre to just make sure that he hasn't popped out somewhere while I've been chatting away. And it would be lovely to have the male lion on foot. Just listening to the vehicles moving about before we accidentally go wandering into their sighting, which is definitely something that we would rather avoid. Steph is wandering behind us. I'll tell you a secret about Steph. Steph at the moment is so stiff from exercise that every time he stands up, sits down, or walks a couple of steps, he starts to groan. Morning, Steph! We're looking at you. Sorry. Steph says he's got nowhere to hide. He's found a stick. He is basically invisible now. We would never know, if I hadn't pointed him out, we would never know that he was there. So there you go. What does James call Steph? The Mystic Boer. The Mystic Boer is over there in the sunrise, looking very, very subtle behind the stick that he is hiding behind. And so we continue on and wait for this lion to pop out somewhere along the line. I was in the process of showing you a gerbil hole that was freshly dug before we disappeared. I'm not entirely sure when we disappeared off your screens. At some point, while I was showing you a freshly dug gerbil hole, but I don't know where it is now. I've forgotten. Apparently it was as we were showing you the finer details of the gerbil hole. And now, of course, it has disappeared. I can't remember exactly where we were that we found it. We'll slowly make our way towards the termite mounds. I think we're going to go and stand up there and have a good look. Perhaps dodge the vehicles and possibly the male lion, depending upon where he decides to arrive. I'll just stop here for one moment. I know that this is becoming a little bit like a broken record, but if you have a look at the damage that's been done by the elephants at the moment, it is just, it's this destruction of the trees. All of these acacia have been damaged by elephants in some way. And it almost looks, if we go and have a look here, actually I'm not 100% sure that that is elephant. That might be something else. But you know that the animals are starting to get desperate when they go for the gwari bushes. So this is a magic gwari bush, and it has been debarked. My first thought was actually buffalo rubbing their horns, which is a possibility, but the bark has been stripped cleanly away. And generally the gwari bushes look as luscious and green as they do because they actually don't have much value in terms of their nutrients. But the fact that it looks as though an elephant has actually come and debarked this gwari bush tells you just how desperate they are for nutrients. And that's of course why we're getting them coming into the camps, into the gardens, into wherever they can be. Great fun thing that they've done. Now I know that Brent was with that male lion, and I know that he's heading in this direction. Let's head across to him, find out how he's doing, and we're going to give him a hand in searching for this particular lion.
Now unfortunately that big male lion managed to give us the slip. The last place we saw him was just behind us, but we're literally in a myriad of little river systems. and I'm just hoping to hear something. I thought I just heard, well, a little bit earlier, I thought I heard a little contact call. But nothing since. Now, unfortunately, there are lion tracks everywhere. So I went for a little walk into the river system here. Tracks of the females and cubs go that way, but then there's tracks going this way, that way. And they have been around this area for quite a while. But I didn't see any male lion tracks crossing. He might have stopped below us somewhere. And we might have over-second-guessed him. But we're going to keep on our search for not only the male lion, but the Holland Guma pride that we're pretty confident is on Juma. Now, guys who watch the Juma Dam cam, they might pop out there, so please keep a lookout for me. But while we do that, James has got a wonderful, elegant antelope.
There is a kudu, everybody, with his fluffy winter fur. And she's just eating on some acacia gerardii, or the red thorn tree. A whole beautiful herd standing here. Now, word on the wireless is that there's a male lion lurking about here somewhere. If any luck, we'll be a bit lucky with that. Especially as it's quite cool still, and they often will lie out in the sun, sort of, to overcome the chills of the evening. A bit like Eggsy and I are doing right now, stopped at these kudu, so we can enjoy the warmth of the sun on our faces. Okay, let's move forward. Nobody seems to know exactly where that male lion is, because I think as soon as the cheetah was seen, he was left alone. Everybody went off that way. That is very lucky. You know, I was just saying how we got lost there. Well, not lost, but I missed a turn off. If I hadn't missed that turn off, we wouldn't have seen those cheetahs. Amazing. Hello, Robin. You've obviously been watching or reading about cheetah, and you say, is it true that it's possible to walk with wild cheetah, that it's easy to walk with them? Robin, it's not easy, but yes, they do habituate. They will habituate much more readily than leopards or lions do, and certainly if they have experience of human beings as youngsters, they tend to be pretty easy to walk with. I think it would be very difficult in an area like this. Certainly it's possible to walk with wild cheetahs where they have been reintroduced, where they're actually quite familiar with people. I think you'd struggle to habituate two adult male cheetahs like that to our presence on foot. But they wouldn't pose a danger. I don't know of a record of cheetah killing human beings. I'm sure it's happened once or twice over the many millions of years that our two sort of kinds have been around each other. But I think it's very uncommon. And certainly as a, I've said before, and Brent's got lots of stories about this sort of thing, where cheetahs have been kept as hunting dogs. Genghis Khan kept a whole stable of cheetah that he used as sort of greyhounds. Right, we're coming out into the first clearing, everybody. Eggsy, keep an eye out for ostriches so that we might attract them with the emu attraction method, which we will attempt a little bit later. There doesn't seem to be a great deal in this vast clearing here. We're going to turn to the left, which is north, because apparently the male lion was on the sort of Ankoral boundary just north of here. Ah, what a marvellous day. Very, very bright sun. Not so, Eggsy?
Yeah.
Now let's see what birdies we can find on the clearing here as we make our way towards the lion. Birchall starling. We won't stop for him because we'll see many of him. But if we see a pipit, well, then we may well stop. A pipit, nondescript, lark-like brown bird that likes to live in these clearings. But I don't see any pipits at the moment. We drive a little bit more quickly, but not far from where I think the lion might be. And then we'll evaluate from there where we're going to go. Where we might find our ostriches. A couple of doves on the ground there. Just keeping an eye out both sides of the road and in front. And let me just try and figure out what's going on here. While I do that, Jamie is still prancing about the place on foot. Let's go and find out what she's found.
Oh, prancing about is perhaps the wrong word, but I have taken to my favourite termite mound, watching Brent race by the way, on his way to some sighting somewhere on Buffles Hook Cutline. I'm going to try and navigate my way down my favourite termite mound. This, is, by the way, is the termite mound that Sindile finished off his appearance on the Father's Day special TV shows. Just maybe 300 metres away from James in the tent and the fireside chat setup that we had over there. And he sat on that termite mound looking absolutely beautiful and regal. And I think, no, that wasn't the last time we saw him. The last time we saw him was with Mvula. And since then, our favourite young male leopard has gone wandering off somewhere and we've got absolutely no idea where he's disappeared to. Keep asking the guides if they've seen him, if they've seen tracks of him. But he appears to have moved off, which makes sense. He's going to search for a nice spot to establish himself in. It's difficult being a young male leopard. In the meantime, we've been following up on impala alarm calls, but they've kind of been a bit half-hearted. Oh, no, these impala are absolutely relaxed. They're over there. They're hidden out amongst the trees of the open area, quite close to quarantine. Totally relaxed. Usually if a leopard or a lion was walking past, whilst they won't necessarily go frantic, they will most definitely be staring off in the direction of that predator, which they're definitely not doing at the moment. They might be looking at Steph, who has vanished. He's managed to find himself a bigger tree. But it does bring us to the subject of the trees and their damage, and Michael was wondering, I mean, like this poor acacia hasn't even really been fed on, it's just been stepped on. You can just imagine it, the elephant just going like this, eating a little bit of it, but nothing really. Brings us to Michael's question, which is, do the trees on quarantine have a substance on them to stop the elephants from eating them? They do now. They've been as part of an experiment to see whether or not it has any effect, and of course this has huge value in terms of human-elephant conflict throughout Africa. But they're testing it on quarantine. There's plenty of food elsewhere for the elephants to feed off. When in an open area like that, they immediately start to target the very large, very old trees. And the answer to that is they've been sprayed by tannins, or with tannins. I was going to say by Nick. So, a young man called Nicholas, who stayed with us for a couple of weeks. Nick sprayed them with some tannins. It remains to be seen if that makes any difference. So you know when elephants feed constantly, as soon as they start to feed off a tree or any browser, the tree starts to release a substance called a tannins. Very, very bitter. It's what makes the... There's a tree there, Jandre. Found it. Well done. Jandre doing a marvellous job of locating the trees for us. The tannins are produced by the plant. It's what makes the spike thorns and the silver cluster leaves taste particularly unpleasant, and it makes it very, very distasteful for the animals to eat. And as a result, the idea is, well, we'll spray the trees with tannins and the elephants are going to immediately just move on and find other food. Remains to be seen, They've also had some tin cans hammered to them with, I believe it was creosote. Creosote is a foul substance. I really don't like it, but it's given me a serious headache before. But it basically is painted onto wood to make it resistant to termites and wood borers and water and so on and so forth. And the... what happened here? Sorry. Unusual tracks in the soil. It remains to be seen whether or not the tannins or the creosote actually work to stop the elephants from feeding off them. This was during the rain. Something slipped here. I love tracks like this, because they tell you a lot about the way that the animal was moving. And I think something skidded and actually caused that brush up of soil. Well, that's quite a lot. Maybe something digging. It doesn't look like something digging, though. And that's skid mark. Perhaps something being chased across quarantine, or just running and playing in the mud. Now, Impala looking very, very relaxed. It's amazing, they've spotted us. And it just goes to show that sometimes your value in terms of the impact that you have on animals, presenting yourself out in the open, talking, not displaying predatory behavior. If we tried to sneak up on those impala, first of all, never try to sneak up on impala because you will not get anywhere near them. They've got incredibly keen senses. But if you're not displaying predatory behavior, which is why when something like a lion or a leopard is just walking past, impala kind of go, bah, every now and again. But they're actually not too concerned about the presence of the predators. And the same goes for us. We're not displaying predatory behavior. I'm not sneaking up on them, I'm not trying to stay hidden or whispering. And as a result, they're actually quite relaxed with our presence. But if I were now to run towards them, they would immediately start alarm calling and disappear off. If I were to sneak around that termite-mounted peak up, they'd get a fright. They're used to being ambushed. But they also know that predators, if they're just walking past, not displaying predatory behavior, then they are absolutely fine. Let's head across to James and find out where he is now that he's had a marvellous morning spent with Cheetah, and we'll catch up with you soon.
There are some impala, everybody. We haven't found anything else. The male lion seems to have moved. And that means it's going to be a little difficult to find him, I think, because he doesn't seem to have come down this way. But a beautiful view of some impalas. And I'm just going to retrieve these binoculars and see, because it looks like there's something standing under a tree on the next clearing. No, it is just another piece of tree standing under the tree on the next clearing. Some quite odd sort of cloud build up there on the horizon, Eggsy will show you eventually. And there it is. And in the background, a hoopoe going boop, boop, boop. Boop, boop, boop. Boop, boop, boop. Boop, boop. Such a lovely sound. Well, all is peace here at Cheetah Plains at the moment. Right, this is the sort of second or third clearings. We're going to go down now to the southern ones on the Mala-Mala boundary to the north, or the northern Mala-Mala boundary, and then we will attempt the ostrich attraction techniques that have been used for emus. Nobody is clear as to whether they work for ostrich or not, but I will demonstrate them to you regardless, and we'll see if they work. I think you might have to have ostriches actually in sight for it to work, but in the meantime, maybe not. Right, in the meantime, Brent, I believe, is hearing after something very What? Ah, sorry. Brent is not quite ready for you. Let's go and see what's in these clearings here. I feel like it's going to be a warmish day, but then that funny cloud buildup tells me maybe there's a front coming through. I read an article again today about La Nina and her potential effects in this area, and apparently potentially big rains somewhere between August and October, so I mean that's quite new. Right, good stuff. Brent is now ready for you with a very special sighting.
So we got a report of a leopard. We weren't sure if it's a male or female. It's in Buffalo's Hook at the moment, but I think that's a female. I can't see at this distance who it is. I'm just going to get my camera out. Maybe you guys can tell me. It looks like a young female to me. Let me get my camera. Get a bit of zoom on. Wow, is that three cats already this morning? Lion, leopard, and cheetah. All the big cats are out and about on this sunrise safari. Oh, look at that. Beautiful in the early morning light. Now the big question is, who are you? Brian, any ideas?
No idea.
So I don't think it's Karula. Ears look too perfect. If I had to hesitate a guess, oh dear, camera's in all the wrong settings. Oh, there she goes. She's busy stalking impala. I'm not sure who it is yet. Okay, we need to move. Lena says, is it Salahesh or Tandi? I don't think so. We're right on the northern edge of Juma. And so it could be Shaluva. I'm just going to let Yours go in front of me because he's going forward and I'm going backwards. How's it, Yours? Nice to see you guys. And I can turn around. And she's stalking Impala. The Impala on Juma. She's on Buffalo's Hook at the moment. I think it could be Shaluva, 2013 model, not the 2005 model. It looks like a young female, but wouldn't it be nice if it's a female we don't know? That would be really exciting. I hope you guys got some screenshots. I didn't manage to get a decent shot of her there. But I mean, I'm happy to have some help in IDing this leopard, if you can. And you think you've got her ID, send it. The answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live. So I'm just trying to see where she's gone. Brian, can you see her? Oh, there she is, top of the termite mound. Look at that, she's popped down again. Using that termite mound as cover to approach the impala. Lost sight of her now, but she's definitely behind that mound. And you see, oh, there she is. Look at that. Isn't that incredible? I lost sight of her, but fortunately, we have the thumb controlling the camera who kept an eye on her. Yo, you just see her ear there. Karen says it could be Tsakani or Tiani. Now, Tiani was seen yesterday in Sibambini, and and Tsakani was last seen south of the Sand River in Sabi Sabi. It is always possible, but unlikely. She's still there, right? I think she's ducked down.
Yeah.
If she comes out. So exciting. Fingers crossed it's a new leopard for the killer bees. But I think it is... I think the most likely individual is Shilua 2013. Almost like, sounds like a make of car, because you've got the 2005 model and the 2013 model. Aaron's wondering if it could it be the Ingrid's Dam female. Aaron, I don't think so. Ingrid's Dam is right on the western edge of Arethusa. I mean, sorry, the southwestern edge of Arethusa, and we're on the northeastern edge of Juma. So it could be a female that's coming in from the north in Buffelshoek, but I think most likely is Shaluva. So she's just behind that termite mound, and I'll show you why she's behind that termite mound and why she's just peeking ever so slightly. It's not because she's worried about us. It's because she's keeping her eye on them. There we go. Some papalalalas. So she's busy stalking them. And the reason she's being so careful is because there's a lot of open ground, as you can see, between her and the impalas. So I think she's probably trying to formulate a way to get from there, where she is, to where the impala are. Is that her ear popping up, Brian? Or is it my wishful imagination? I think it's my wishful imagination. So she is behind that termite mound. We're just going to sit tight here and wait for her to move. What do you think, Brian? Shaluva?
Yeah, Shaluva.
I think it's Shaluva as well. But I'm happy to be wrong. Maybe it's an unnamed, unknown ghost from the north. One of Gajima's consorts. Okay. So she is still there. There are some vehicles in Buffelshoek who can see her. But she is behind the termite mound, and as I said, we're right on the northern edge of our traverse, northeastern edge of our traverse. But good for us, the impala are in Juma. So we're just going to sit tight right here. And hopefully she slinks. So I think she's going to come from there, and she's going to use this available cover here in front of us. It's the best way. And then maybe even go a bit further towards the drainage line. And then obviously crossing the road is going to be a difficult part. And then I think she's going to stick in these trees. And I think she's going to come to the impala. Ooh, my alarm's not long enough. Sorry, that's the route I think she's going to use to get to those impala. So, as I always say, the most important weapon in our arsenal for seeing the best stuff in the world is patience. So while Brian and I play the patience game, let's go back to Jamie on bushwalk.
The idea on bushwalk actually at the moment is to play the patience game as well. And I'm going to explain exactly what I mean to you in one moment. But first of all, just have a look at this particular scene. We've got something, and I've been dying to do this, and I really, really hope that it works today. First of all, these little, if we look at here, these little tracks, little just dots in the sand, and the odd scrape mark. And those tracks, apart from the fact that it's in a giant elephant track, which is also really awesome, with its wrinkles and everything, so an elephant's come and dug here, but it's actually disturbed the home of my favorite spider. Well, that's a I would say it's my favorite spider. It's called a baboon spider, and she's living inside this hole, and she's here now. And the reason I know that she's here now is because she's got fresh webbing across, and also these tracks are very, very fresh from last night. Now, what I'm going to try and do, without making too much of a disturbance, is just see. We're fishing for a spider. And again, it's a patience game. Hey, girl. Are you going to bite? Oh, it's a deep one. Wow. So what often happens if you do this, you've got to do it really delicately, is you can actually get them to grab the end of the grass stem, and they pull, and they are so, so strong. Hold on, let's see if it's... That's the wind that's moving it. On a still day, you can actually see them moving the grass. Come on, are you sleeping? Fair enough, I guess. I've been dying to fish out a baboon spider to show you, because we hardly ever get to see the big ones. And this particular baboon spider would be just a little bit smaller than my palm, judging by the size of... There we go, I've got her. Hello. The force that they exert, it's like fishing. The force that they exert on the other end of this grass blade is incredible. For the size... Jeepers, she's pulling. Watch this. That's now not just the wind, that's the spider moving this. Oh, she's got it. Come on. Uh-oh. You've got to be so patient. Come on. Come on. I've done this before and I've fished out some enormous spiders, and it's very, very important that you don't get into their eye line. Otherwise, they get too scared to come out of their holes. She's coming. Oh, wow. Come on, big girl. Come on. She's coming. Oh, I think she saw my hand. Come on. Come on. You've got to be so, so patient. She's coming. You can see her massive hairy legs. They are my absolute best. Come on. In Hoedspruit, the area that we, most of us, love and live in, the main town that's close to us, there is a species of baboon spider called a golden baboon spider. And that is... Oh, I think she's given up. Did you get to see her, Jandre? Oh, that's so cool. Come on. Out you come. And this species of spider is big. Come. Oh, you're so strong. Oh, you are so strong. She just chomped through this grass. There we go. How cool is that? Come on. Awesome. One more try. I'm loving this so much. I love baboon spider. They are fascinating. Really ancient, primitive spider. Active hunters. Come on. I see you. How cool is that? Okay. Shall we leave our baboon spider now? We've done some fishing. What I was going to say is the golden baboon spider is so heavily endangered and endemic to the Hoedspruit region that if you want to build anywhere there and they find a baboon spider hole that belongs to a golden baboon spider and you try and destroy that, you'll be fined or sentenced to jail for up to 20 years. Now, South Africa is a place with its troubles, but the amazing thing is we have some really, truly incredible wildlife protection laws, and stuff like that makes me so happy. That spider was absolutely... I'm so glad I got to do that. We didn't get it all the way out, but I'm not going to try and torment it anymore. Not torment it, but just try and fish it out any further. They are nocturnal creatures, so we're going to leave it to its daytime snooze. Let's head back across to Brent to see if that leopard has popped out and find out who she is.
So we're still not sure who she is. She's still currently just to the north of our northern boundary. And you can see there, she's a relaxed around vehicles, which means she's probably grown up in the Sabi Sands, not in the Kruger or the Manuleti. But who she is, that still remains a mystery. I'm still leaning towards Shaluva, but as I said, I might be completely wrong. She's still watching those impala quite intently. It's definitely a young female. You're a pretty lady, aren't you? Just come a bit closer so we can identify you, please. Oh, she's heard something behind her. No, that's bad. No impala that side. Please be impala our side. Was that a bit of saliva I saw drop there? She must be hungry. See how her ears are flat? It's so she doesn't stick out from the termite mound. So they're not sitting upright like they normally would. Now, there were some hyena calling. Maybe she's reacting to that. What are you up to? They're such elegant creatures. And you've got the majesty of the lions. But I would say, if lions are majestic, leopards are chic. That's exactly, I mean, any female leopard would look at home on the cover of Vogue or Elle or any of those type of glossy magazines. Towards us, please. Please come this way. Don't go the other way. Now, once we identify this female, it's going to be quite interesting to see who she is, where she fits in the grand scheme of things, especially with the ever-changing leopard dynamics that we're dealing with, particularly with females. So normally changing leopard dynamics happens with the males, but in this, at the moment, we've got incredibly interesting female dynamics. Shadow has been pushed into a tiny, tiny sliver, with Salahesh moving further and further to the east. Karula has moved further to the south, I think due to the amount of lion and hyena activity that's happening in the north, and there is definitely a gap in the northern part of what was once Karula's territory for another. The female leopard. Now, where we are, and a young female with a little bit of chutzpah might be tempted to push in and challenge her for this little corner of her territory. And the Shadul. And sorry, I just had to point out where she was as Aubrey came past. No impala. Don't be any impala behind. Come to the impala on Juma. Everyone send this unknown female leopard. Positive thought saying, eat impala on Juma. No, it says it looks like that large termite mounds have multiple benefits for predators. Most definitely, it gives them a wonderful spot to survey from. And also quite often, and that termite mound is probably not the best example of that, is that there's often on active termite mounds, there's a chimney or two that stick out. So if they pop their head over there, but keeping their ears flat, to a lot of the animals, it might just look like another chimney on the termite mound. And from a safety point of view, it's a good place because you can survey all around you and make sure nothing sneaks up on you. You can use it to look for prey. And it's quite nice to bask in the sun on as well. Who are you? It's such a mystery. I love a good mystery, don't you, Brian? Aren't you just, I can't figure out who it is. And that's really exciting. Because normally when we see a leopard within about half a second, we're like, oh, Karula, Tingana, Shadow. But this is a wonderful, wonderful thing. Unfortunately, she is a bit far, which is making it a bit difficult. Well, Cheryl says Shaluva has two distinct notches on her right ear. Possibly we could use the camera to check. Now, Brian is going to go full zoom. And on this camera, Cheryl, unfortunately, that is full zoom. So I've been looking with binoculars, and even at binoculars, she's quite far away. But we shall definitely try, Cheryl, to see if she's got two notches in her right ear. Thank you very much for that, Cheryl. But Cheryl, are you talking about Shaluva 2005 or Shaluva 2013? Mm-hmm. I'm assuming you're talking about Shaluva 2013 because this is a young female, definitely not an 11-year-old. Go, Brian. I was fiddling with my binoculars. She slinked towards us. No, bad leopard, naughty leopard. She's going the wrong way, Brian. Brian, stop it.
I'll try.
Okay. Okay, good. We'll herd her. It's okay if she sees something to the south, just not to the east. Okay, there we go. How's that, Brian? Actually, I might be able to get a camera shot with a light there. Can someone tell me what Shaluva's spot pattern is, please? If you know Shaluva's spot pattern, let me know. Questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. What is Shaluva 2013 spot pattern? So I've got her right hand spots. Just waiting to get a good one of her left hand spots. If it is Shluva 2013. Brian, this is the second time we've ever seen this leopard. But as I said, it might not be her. I don't know. I'm doubting myself for a moment, Brian. I'm almost thinking it might be Tsakani, and that would be incredibly impressive. She's covered many kilometers. No impala. Why are there more impala and buffalo? So look at her go. Oh. You got it, Brian? Okay, I'm just going to concentrate on reversing. I've lost her. And she's stopped behind that thicket. Oh no, there she is, there she is. Well, she's coming closer to us. That's the best news ever. Okay. Thank you very much. Karen. Karen says Shaluva is a 3-3. There's a Stenbok. Ah, that's what she's so focused on. Okay, I'm going to switch off now. Don't want to affect what's going on. So I'm just trying to get spot patterns. So, Brian, have you spotted the Stenbok here? Yeah, so there's about 30 meters. Oh, it's spotted her. No, it hasn't spotted her. Look at that. I love it. Look at that. That absolute concentration. So the Stenbok is walking towards her. Walking towards her. Hasn't seen her. Look at that. Look at that. Oh, look at that absolute fluid motion. Definitely the chicest animal in the bush. That's why ladies like to wear leopard print, I suppose, Brian, because it just looks that good. Personally, I prefer it on animals. Okay, so the Stenbok is now less than 15 meters. It's unfortunately in a very difficult spot. You can just make it out there. But she is now 15 meters. But I think let's stick on the leopard. Because I trust, okay, base of that fallen terminalia. You got her there. There we go, there she is. Now, fortunately we've got the fastest cameraman on today. Look at that, look at that, look at that, look at that. We don't want to move the vehicle right now. Oh, Stenbok spotted her. And gone. That was so close though. Brian, I really thought we were going to get a kill this morning. Let's just get it. Oh, she's still hunting it even though it ran away. Say when, Brian? How's that? Oh, she's going back to whence she came. The Stenbok has escaped. The impala is still on Juma. So let's hope she's going to come down towards Juma. Think we're going to be, let's keep going. Hopefully we'll be able to get over the bump without starting the car. Oh no, no, she's changing direction again. Of course she is. I almost said something and probably got me into trouble. I was going to say, typical female, changing her mind all the time. She's unfortunately delving deeper into Buffle's hook. And I think we're going to lose her. We are. Okay, we're going to lose her. Unfortunately, she's going deeper into the north. But let me just get on the radio and then I'll be back with you. Andrew, she's going deep into Buffalo's Hook. I'll leave for you guys. Okay, so she's disappearing into Buffalo's Hook. Now, just need a quick reminder. I think Karen said Shaluva's a 3-3. Well, exciting news, Brian. It's definitely not Shaluva. Oh, so I'm just going to get away from the sighting a little bit, and then we're going to stop and have a look at the photographs of her sport pattern. Oh, who could it be? Who could it be? But anyway, we'll have a look at that. I'm going to keep you in suspense a little longer. We're going to go carry on looking for lions again, and of course elephants, since it is World Elephant Day. But while we do that, let's go see what James is up to.
We are looking into the thick bush there, because there was a bird, but it is now absconded. It was a forked-tailed drongo, and the reason we stopped for it, which is not an unusual bird, of course, is that it was shouting at something, I think, in this pile of sticks here, and I wondered if there wasn't maybe a snake. Eggsy, do you see a snake anywhere? Not really. You may hear the tapping in the background. It is not a woodpecker. It is the maintenance shed at Chitwa Chitwa. Or Annette's, I think it's called. No, no snake in there, Eggsy. I thought those were elephants for a second, and then I realized it was, in fact, the banging of a hammer. This is entirely normal, because, of course, you cannot be banging around the camp when your guests are in camp having a lion, or perhaps enjoying a pre-lunch gin and tonic, so it's got to be done while they're on game drive. And in winter, that sound travels a very long way. Now, I'm just going to consult my map. I thought we'd maybe have been trespassing again, but we managed not to, which is a good thing. Yeah, we'll get this way. We're on the far eastern boundary now of, sorry, western boundary of Cheetah Plains. Now turning back to the east. And you can see, and I'm sure you were seeing this while you were with that leopard and Brent, the weather is turning somewhat. Which is very sad, because the bits of sun that we've been sitting in have been most pleasant upon our skin, cold as it has been. There has not been a great flurry of activity from when I last saw you. There was nothing in the clearings. And then we came all the way along the southern boundary of Cheetah Plains, and I said there was one Duiker, highly mobile, south into Mala Mala, and a couple of Impala. So the male lion, I'm not sure where he went. What is that through there? It's a fallen tree, Eggsy. That's all it is. I was also hoping we might have sign of the Styx pride with their little cubs. I haven't seen those little cubs yet. Now Brent and Jamie have seen them. And I was hoping we might find them. But that doesn't seem to be offing either at the moment. Right, here is Juma Dam, interestingly so named. Now, I'm not sure if we can get over the dam wall here without falling off it. No, we can't. We can go around the front. Ooh, smell that, Eggsy? What did you smell? Say, potato bush. I want to see if I can find the very strong smell. Bush, obviously, but which individual is making the smell? Because once you pick them, the smell disappears almost entirely. Ooh, very stiff. It's so strong here that I'm sure one of them is flowering. It's really very powerful. There is one there on the, you see that bush on the damn wall there? That is a potato bush. Let me go and just check that one quickly. Might find the lion cubs. this one? As soon as you get close to them, though, they don't smell. Can you still hear me, Eggsy? The very colour, very pretty colour, everybody. If I was a fashionista, I might be inclined to make a textile or something that was that colour. Very fashionable bush clothing, wouldn't it be? There's the potato bush. Now, what I would like you to do is take a deep breath in. Am I too close to you? Take a deep breath in, everybody. And what you will smell will take you way back to your childhood, to the first time you went into a McDonald's, which hopefully you don't do anymore. And it smells like that. It's the most unbelievable smell. There's a fruit on it too. There's the potato bush fruit, which is not a potato, obviously. There we are. And what smells is just the tiny little flowers. Tiny little flowers here and buds in the middle of the plant. Right, there you are, Eggsy. That can be my gift to you today. You being from Cape Town, you can also have that stick. Well done. Eggsy's gone through something of a transformation, everybody. He arrived with his hipster outfits. He still distressingly wears the skinny pants, but that's okay. But yesterday, he paraded his new bush uniform. Very nice, Eggsy. He now looks like a bush hipster, as opposed to just a hipster. It's such a strong smell, that. If Brenty's managed to relocate his leopard, let's go and find out.
So exciting! It's a new leopard for all of us. I've never even heard of her. I've just had a chat to Aubrey on the radio, and that reminds me I better turn it down because otherwise it'll come through like a foghorn. But apparently her name is Gutula, the quiet one, or quiet, and she comes from the north. And she's got a 4'4 or 4'5, and she was a bit far. But you see, there's a very small dot. It's not so visible on the frontal shot, but if we go to the side shot, there we go. So there's a small dot, 1, 2, 3, 4, and that's on her right. And then on her left, I see a small dot there. Do you see it, Brian? So I think it's a 4, 5. So 4 big ones, 1 small one. And the other side, 3 big ones, 1 small one. Gutula, the quiet one. And some people were a bit worried about how close the vehicles were to her. They were perfectly fine. I must remember, things often appear a lot closer on our cameras than they actually are. But her reactions around the vehicles were of a completely relaxed leopard with vehicles. And she was more focused on hunting, so the vehicles did not affect her at all. You could see by her body language that she was completely fine. But I just want to go, killer bees, new leopard, yes! Love it, Brian, I love it. Love your work, Brian.
Thank you.
Okay, so now I feel like Juma is our oyster. We are going to find many things. I think since it is World Elephant Day, we should go look for some elephants. Now, I still haven't got a correct answer for my elephant quiz. Now, could it be possible that I have got you guys stumped on two drives in a row? Firstly, the Waltharia on bushwalk yesterday. And now, we're the largest bodied, heaviest, tallest elephants in Africa. We've had Ethiopia, Angola, Namibia, Malawi. Now, Angola, if we look historically, is a very good answer. The largest elephant bull ever recorded, weighing just under 10 tons, 10,000 kilograms, over 20,000 pounds was from Angola, but that was an anomaly. It seems like his growth hormone, his pituitary gland or whatever it was on steroids, but that was an individual. So not common occurrence, and it's the biggest male elephant ever recorded was from Angola, from southern Angola. Now, the elephants of southern Angola, since it is World Elephant Day, are incredible. So Angola had a very, very rough last 50 years or so, and civil wars and lots of wars, put it that way, and a very mineral-rich country, diamonds, oil, gold, and that funny thing I can never remember, but I'm sure Brian knows, they put into cell phones. You know what I'm talking about? It's a weird mineral that is used in sort of all circuitries and whatnot, and is it coltan? Could be coltan. I might be completely talking nonsense, but I know it's a very specific, very rare mineral that is used heavily in the electronics, especially with the smartphone industry. And that is the two best places to mine that are actually in Angola and in Congo. But even before that was discovered, it's a very tough area, and much civil wars, and many, many landmines laid specifically in the southern part of the country. And for many years, if you traveled along the northern boundary of Namibia, elephants with half trunks, half feet blown off by landmines. But elephants are incredible animals. So what has happened is the elephants will walk into this area, and they've started utilizing these areas again. And of course, where there's lots of landmine, there's not many people. So from an animal point of view, it's great. Except for the landmines. So what the elephants do is that it's incredible. So Elephant Without Borders has been doing studies on this. Where there's landmine fields, the elephants have learned from explosions, etc., to smell out landmines. I mean, they use rats, dogs to smell out landmines. So basically the elephants stay in single file in these massive paths through the landmine fields. They get to an area where there's no landmines, they spread out and start feeding. But then get to another landmine field, single file, not one elephant stepping off the path, which I find absolutely amazing. And that's in southern Angola. Oh, what bird is that flying? It's flying very fast, unfortunately. But we'll keep going, looking for elephants on World Elephant Day. But I'm still just on top of the world, a new leopard. And I do love the name, Kutula. The quiet one, so the opposite to me. Now, while I was rushing to get there, oh, we have a correct answer, and it's a very specific question. So at the moment, the largest bodied and tallest elephants in Africa are in South Africa, in Tembe Elephant Park. Now, it's an incredible reserve, and actually one of my sort of favorite secrets almost, Tembe Elephant Park. Not many people go there, and it's a bit out of the way. It's on the border of Mozambique, and it's mostly sand forest. And sand forest is a very unique type of dry forest, and that occurs in northern KwaZulu-Natal and up into southern Mozambique. And most sand forests have been obliterated by man, but there's a couple of patches, and Tembe Elephant Park is one of the biggest patches of sand forest left. Incredible birds, but incredible elephants. They do move through into Mozambique as well. Actually, a very good friend of mine studied them for many years. But on average, elephants of Tembe weigh about 500 kilograms more than most elephants, and they are considered to be part of the sort of greater Kruger or low felt of South Africa thing, but they've been quite isolated from other elephant populations for quite a while. They're also much taller, so I think an average Tembe bull is about 4 meters at the shoulder, and here we're looking at about 3.5. So incredible part of the world. And also Isilo, who was the biggest tusker that's lived in the last known tusker that's lived in the last while, was from Tembe as well. And it was Chris Rogue who got that spot on. Well done, Chris. Now, since you have got the first elephant quiz, I've had so many in store for you, and we're going to have to go to another one, but I'm still just on a high from the new leopard. While I think of my next elephant quiz for you, let's go back to Commander Bond, who's looking at little scrapes in the sand.
I don't think I'm Commander Bond, unless Brent has switched his nicknames around for myself and James. But nevertheless, moving swiftly on, because it's not like I haven't made that mistake before, we have got, while Brent's been keeping your minds busy, the lions have been keeping our minds busy, leaving us tracks in the sand for us to decipher. Now, Steph is forging ahead. He's quite determined, I think, to track these lions down. We've been tracking them ever since we left, pretty much ever since we left that baboon spider. And I think that we narrowly missed them. The reason that I say that, and I mean, it's not so clear here, but a little bit further back, we had some fresh elephant dung, still warm elephant dung, with a fresh track, but with lion tracks on top of them, which tells us that these lions walked along this path towards the dam camera not too long ago, probably maybe 2 hours ago. I think that the male that's with them, I think that he is the one that Brent had and lost on Gallagher Shortcut, but my strong suspicion is that these lionesses and their cubs are somewhere here. And what I want to show you, and now I've lost them all. Where did they go? We've been following cub tracks the whole time, and now I can't find one. I wanted to show you the size difference, and it's not as remarkable as you think it would be. Okay, it's not a very clear example, but it'll do. Unless there's a clearer one here. Sorry. I did see them earlier. I had it all planned out. But, oh, there we go. Okay, here's a nice-ish example. This is the lion, the adult lion's track. This is the back of its foot, just to draw it out, make it a bit clearer. There's its toesies. There's a leaf in my way. And that's roughly the size. So about, we've done this before, but about the size of my hand, give or take. And next to it, is a little baby track, a little cub track. This is the back of its foot, and its toes are here. The squirrel's very cross. I wonder if it's... No, it's not lions. Here's the little cub track. It's roughly the size of my palm. It's about the size of Karula's tracks, give or take a little bit. So there you go. The little cub track is about the size. Now, leopard and lion cubs, like puppies, have feet that look far too big for their bodies, and their tracks actually catch up far faster than you would expect them to with the adults. Now, Hosanna, for example, and this now I'm talking about leopards, that's Karula's male cub. In the next, I would guess that the next 2, maybe 3 months, his track is going to be bigger than his mother's. So the size of the animal, their feet are usually the first thing to grow. Just like your puppies at home, for those of you that have puppies and stumble over their feet. Lions are exactly the same. And already the cub tracks are past the size of a leopard tracks, and that I think is the youngest set of, or not the oldest set of Nkuhuma cubs that walked along here. And just in terms of aging them, it's now very windy. I can tell you that they were a couple of hours old. And the reason I say that is because a dove of some description has walked on top of the tracks. And that's one of the big reasons why it's important to know the little tracks as well. Here's its toes here. To know the little creature's tracks. They might not be something that you're going to plan on tracking down in the same way you would a lion or a leopard, but they will help you age the track. So frogs, mice, tortoises, doves, all of those are specific times of the day that they're active, and if they're on top of your tracks, it tells you a little bit more about when that track was made. I'm going to try and catch up with Steph, who has now vanished. He's on a mission. There he is, far in the distance, disappearing off. I'm going to try and... he's hidden in the dam. He's gone into the dam. He's gone. Maybe he's thirsty. But I think he's on a mission searching for the lions. So we're going to continue on. I think the females are somewhere in this vicinity. We'll be careful as we go. But we are going to go and search. And in the meantime, I'm going to send you back onto the vehicle for an update that side.
Everybody, let's look at this tree here next to us. It's a gardenia tree. It will flower, hopefully, at some stage during the course of the summertime.
delicious smelling flowers. Not that one, Eggsy. That's a quarry bush. There we are. And I have a small, relatively interesting story to tell you about the gardenia tree. And that was a story of when I was on my very first game drive. I remember being panicked by giving people silence in the bush. Now, on these sort of live safaris, just driving along and not saying anything for extended periods is obviously just a little bit awkward. But you can do that for, you know, 10, 20 minutes sometimes if you've got people on the back of the vehicle and they're listening and they're looking and they're just sort of enjoying the atmosphere of the place. Well, when I was a young guide, young buck, so many years ago, 16 years ago now, Eggsy, when you were, well, you were just a child, weren't you? I was driving along one evening, picking bits of leaves and handing them to my guests, telling them about what tree it was. I mean, they didn't know what I was talking about half the time. It was pitch black darkness, they couldn't identify the tree, but at least it kept me talking. And one of those trees, I remember being the gardenia on my very first drive. Driving at night, not seeing anything, thinking, oh my goodness, I've got to tell these people something. And I stopped next to a gardenia tree, picked the leaves and handed them to these guests who were very surprised to have been handed a mangled bunch of leaves in the pitch black darkness, which they would never have been able to identify, possibly even in the daytime. And that is my small, relatively interesting story about the gardenia. And Andrew, while we look at a white-crowned shrike, Eggsy, do you see them? Two of them?
Yep.
Excuse me, everyone. Andrew, you want to know what my favorite tree is? My favorite tree, Andrew, is something called a Lowveld milkberry, or Manilkara murchisa. I haven't seen any around here. If we see one, I'll show you. This is the white-crowned shrike, and they make the most amazing little nests, perfect little cups lined with spiders' webs and leaves and grass held together with intricate weaving in the spiders' webs. And then they lay their little eggs inside, and somehow that bird fits into the tiny nest and incubates and protects its eggs and then its little hatchlings. Normally sort of on the way out on a branch on the end of a tree. Of course, as we head now towards the springtime, so the birds will be starting to become quite amorous with each other. Still haven't seen a Wahlberg's eagle yet, which is we're now getting to the stage where we really should see one. I think the first one we saw last year was maybe the 16th of August, maybe. Someone will remember that. Eggsy, I seem to have developed consumption on our way here in the cold. There we go. I'm okay now. Don't worry. The last thing to tell you about the white-crowned shrike is obviously you notice the distinctive little tooth on the end of the bill there. And that is very distinctive of the shrikes. While I die of consumption, says Kirsten, we can link to Brent for an update. When we see you next, we will probably be back on Juma. We're going to leave Cheetah Plains now.
So in my waffling, I actually gave away one of my quizzes, which was where was the heaviest elephant ever discovered. So it made me think a little bit deeper about elephants. And of course, we are in the Greater Kruger National Park, home to about 16,000 elephants on World Elephant Day. So there are a group of elephants known as the Magnificent Seven that are famous in the Kruger area. Now, they are obviously the seven most magnificent bulls to have existed. There's a couple currently that might be challenging, but they're in very difficult parts of the park to get to. But speaking of the Magnificent Seven, I've got two questions, and that is definitely not an elephant. And looking a bit bemused that there's no World Buffalo Day, only a World Elephant Day, he's looking a little bit upset about that, aren't you? Mr. Duggar Boy. They do look bemused. He's chewing the cud, avoiding the lines, chewing the cud. A nice old boy, probably around 10 or 11 years old. One of the Juma Pan gang, I assume. Hello, silly cow. There's a couple of them around. This guy's out in the open. The others are in a bit thickets, but there's not three or four of them that we can see. There's probably a few more that we can't. Yeah, I can hear more. Oh, swallow. There we go. And next ball up. Of course, once he's decided he's extracted as many nutrients as possible out of his cud bolus, swallows it and brings up another one. Well, Mr. Buffalo, it's not World Buffalo Day, so we're going to leave you to be and carry on looking for elephants, since it is World Elephant Day. So, back to the Magnificent Seven. And since we are in the Greater Kruger, well, the next quiz for World Elephant Day is... it's a dual quiz. Which elephant in the Greater Kruger, and I've already given it half the answer away because it is part of the Magnificent Seven, has the longest recorded tusks in the Greater Kruger? And that is the first question. And the second question, which elephant had the heaviest tusks recorded in the Greater Kruger? So there we go. There's your elephant quizzes. Now, one of the sort of current biggest elephants, I actually think he might have expired. I need to research that. But one of the current biggest elephants, is only one of the really, only really big tusker that comes into, or used to come into the southern Sabi sands. But it was a single tusked elephant, and its name was Maliliwan. And Maliliwan is a wonderful Shangaan word, which means eyebrows. And it's named after Harry Kirkman, the first warden of the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. Now, if you want to see the most impressive, largest, bushiest eyebrows that have ever existed on a human being, see if you can find a photo of Harry Kirkman online. Literally, when you see those eyebrows, you sort of go, oh, my goodness. It is the bit largest and fluffiest eyebrows I've ever seen on a human being. I mean, they dominate his face. But he was the first warden of the Sabi Sands. And that single-tusked bull used to come into the Sabi Sands. I think when I last saw him, he must have been close on 50 years old. And that was 10 years ago. So the likelihood of him, there's still a small possibility he might still be alive. But it is unlikely. But there we go. Remember, what elephant of the greatest seven, or the Magnificent Seven, had the longest tusks ever recorded in the Greater Kruger, and which elephant had the heaviest tusks ever recorded in the Greater Kruger? And send your answers through to questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Now, enough of my waffling along, because it is World Elephant Day, and I think James has some elephants.
I wouldn't ordinarily have stopped here, everybody, but there in the distance on Torchwood, north of Nkoro, we are on the far sort of corner of where we're allowed to be, there is an elephant. And as it is World Elephant Day, well, I thought you might like to see an elephant. You can see it's that bit of grey there in the bush. There's a whole herd of them. Let's just sit here for a few minutes and see if they come out. I'm not sure they're aware it's World Elephant Day. What do you think, Eggsy? Do you think they are? I'm not sure that they really care. We care, though. A bit like Eggsy will care when it's World Egg Day on the 14th of October. We must remember that, of course. You'll probably write a blog about it as well, Eggsy. Hello, miss. Very nice question from you about elephant communication. While we look at that one, hoping that it might come a little bit closer to us. Miss, you want to know if any research has been done into their sounds and whether there are different dialects between different groups. Miss, they do... research into elephant sounds and communication is ongoing. I think that it's a fascinating subject that continues to baffle many. We know that they communicate, obviously, with those low rumbles, apparently up to 40 sounds or so, six of which, plus minus, are unique to males, and about 20 of which are unique to the cows, and then the rest they share. So, I guess much like our own species, the cows within a herd need to communicate, obviously, because they're with other members of the herd all the time. The bulls not so much, because they are largely solitary when they're adults. Now, what is interesting is that, so what your question is basically, wouldn't a Kruger elephant understand an elephant from Amboseli in Kenya? I don't know. I'm just trying to think, you know, if you were an alien, if you were Zorg the alien and you came down to Earth and found, say, I don't know, African people here and then Hungarians, for example, do you think that the Hungarian and the Zulu would probably sound the same? They probably would, because it's the same method of communication. It's created in the same way. It's done through the vocal cords. So, you know, when we hear elephants from Amboseli and elephants from here, we don't really hear a difference. Would they hear a difference? I think that's a really fascinating question to which I don't know the answer. I'd say it's quite likely that the odd dialect, that or sound or squeak or low stomach rumble, that possibly is a little bit different. Very good question. I think the easiest way to answer it, or maybe the getting to an answer, would be to look at animals like primates and find out, because we're pretty good, not when I say we, there are researchers who are pretty good at interpreting monkey alarm calls, for example. They can tell, you know, five or six different monkey alarm calls, and whether those would apply in various parts of the world would be very interesting. Nice question. Thank you, miss. The best kind, because you can't really answer it. You see a wind blowing, strange northwesterly breeze, normally a warm wind, today a fairly chilly one. There we go. Mrs. Elephant, it's World Elephant Day, it's your day. Phew, lucky we had the long lens today, Eggsy. Yes. Very peaceful. You can maybe just hear the rustling of the leaves in the wind. There's elephants completely at peace, and I am just slightly astounded by how few elephants we've seen in comparison with yesterday. Brent's been on Juma, where you couldn't drive around a corner yesterday evening without finding an elephant, and I don't think he's bumped into any today. Jamie's been out on a walk. She hasn't seen any elephants. Hello, Rachel. You're a new viewer. It's lovely to hear from you, but please do tell us where you're watching from. It would be really nice to know next time you ask us a question. You say, are there any elephants that I'm hoping to see today? Well, yes. I do have a favorite little herd. I think she might be the sort of owner of a... what am I saying? I think she might be our favorite, the favorite matriarch of a number of Wild Earth people. And she is an elephant cow that's missing the bottom third of her trunk, and she's got a little group of three with her, two of which are definitely her offspring, one of which could be an offspring or a sibling. And that little herd is sort of all on its own, and sometimes it joins up with a bull or two, but basically they are forging their independence. She's very young to be leading a herd, and we've spent quite a lot of time with them, and they're just fantastic to watch. It's lovely to have the story of their lives enrich our driving around here. So she would be a herd that I'd like to see or her herd would be what I'd like to see today. The rest of them, you know, there are one or two that we recognize quite easily, some others that we think we recognize, and then many that we're not really sure about, you know. So I'm not sure if I've seen these ones before. Chances are I have. And you've got that that very distinctive cow called Fang. She's got an enormous tusk that's sort of recurved, that looks like it surely must stab her in the leg as she walks. There they are crossing now onto Nkoro, everyone. Felicity in New Zealand, lovely to hear from you, and I can answer your question. You say, are there any flowers or treats or food sources that an elephant would go for, you know, sort of at the expense of everything else? Yes, absolutely. And it would most certainly be marula fruits. So in January and February, when the marulas are on the trees, the elephants go crazy for them. They're very sweet, very delicious, very rich in vitamin C. And the elephants will really go mad to try and eat as many as they can in the short time that the fruiting occurs. Hello, Charlotte. You're wondering about weaning and you're in Denmark. It's wonderful to hear from all these places, New Zealand, Denmark, Australia we've had today. Even South Africa. Charlotte, they start weaning probably, well, I mean, they'll start eating grass at less than a year old. They'll start trying to eat bits and pieces of vegetation, but they'll only wean fully, some of them, when they're about 3 or 4 years old. So, although they will start eating grass and bits and pieces fairly early on, it's not till they're about 3 or 4 that they will wean completely. This is a nice big herd of elephants. They've suddenly turned towards us, which is quite nice. See if they come all the way down the road. I don't think they will. Now there's a car behind them, which you probably saw. That's a vehicle from one of the lodges here. And those big cows were just shepherding the calves across the road. Well, this has turned into quite a decent elephant sighting, Eggsy. Very nice. And Tasha, you say, do the young calves understand the mother's speech, or do they just follow her movement? Actually, I don't think we know, but I imagine it takes them time to learn the language in the same way that humans would. I also think the language is more complicated than we think it is. Here's a bull following the herd. I'm just going to wait here for him. There he comes. Good morning, Sean. How are you? It is, yes. We've missed you horribly, you know. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Are you well?
Hi, James.
Hello. if you like. It's been, yes, it's been a really rough day. Yeah, no, it's what we have to do. Bye-bye. That's Sean, everyone, from Arethusa. He is just appreciating the magnificence of the day. They've been looking at the cheetah, of course, which has been very pleasant. And we'll just wait for that bull to come across the road. How's it? There goes Ryan, also from Arethusa, who I didn't recognize on account of the fact that his beard is no longer with him. Eggsy, you see how young he looked? It's a young bull, everyone. He's not a big bull, but definitely a bull trailing the herd. I suspect he was born into this herd. and he's just not quite ready to go on his own and be independent. Very difficult for us men to become independent, Iggy, don't you find? Hello, Aaron, in New Zealand. You say, after all my time in the bush, is there any particular elephant sighting that sticks out in my mind? I'm trying to think. There have been many, you know. I think elephants on foot tend to have the most profound effect. Now, I haven't had any very close encounters for some time. And a close encounter with an elephant on foot is not always the best idea. But I think probably my time with elephant on foot, and I can't think of anything that really sticks out, Aaron, but for example, the other night when I sat up in my bed and looked out the window and I couldn't see anything because there was an elephant less than a foot from the window. And being that close to an elephant, you can smell their skin, you can see the color of their eyes, glinting in the moonlight. It just gives you a sense of something that no other animal manages to pass over. They communicate in some kind of subliminal way that is very difficult to kind of describe unless you've experienced it. So, Aaron, I'm afraid I'm going to have to disappoint you and say I can't think of one particular elephant experience that sticks out in my mind. If I do, I will let you know. Very pretty bull. And he's just staying in auditory and olfactory communication with the herd. So they'll be rumbling away at each other, and he'll just be listening and following up with them and smelling where they've been and just drawing comfort, I suppose, from being around other elephants. Look at him using his foot there to break the sticks. Just watch carefully. That is very dense wood, so I mean, for us to go and break it would not be very easy at all. But for this elephant, amazing dexterity with the trunk and the foot. He's not having much luck there. Charlotte, you're in Denmark, obviously, we know that. And I've now forgotten your question. Kirsten, may I have it again, please? Ah, yes. How old are the males when they leave the herd? Charlotte, they are about 17. So it probably could be as early as 15 and probably as late as 20 or so. I'd put this guy at around about 18 or 19. But from about 17, their testosterone levels become unwieldy, to the extent that they will start challenging other bulls and becoming a nuisance, and they'll bully other elephants. And the mothers, or the matriarchs and the older females, then get sick of them. And they'll chase them, not maybe away from the herd, but they'll keep them on the fringes of the herd until the elephant becomes, I guess he just kind of falls off the edge of the herd, basically. Normally, he'll hook up with a couple of bulls his own age, or if he's very lucky, he'll meet up with a really big bull who will then sort of take him under his wing as a mentor. So I think we'll just sit with him for a little bit longer. That vehicle you can hear is Tristan from Simbambili coming towards us. All right, let's go across to Jamie and get an update on bushwalk. We'll sit here for a little bit longer. Good morning. How are you? Full of joy? Yeah.
The lions have been leading us in circles. We think we found where the male split off, and it's probably, it may or may not be the same male that Brent had earlier this morning, but he split off from the females, so now we're going to just try and get an idea, at least for the start of the sunset safari, which directions the female and the cubs went. There were at least three sets of female tracks, and there were definitely cub tracks from early this morning. They've got to be around here somewhere. And it's usually with the Nkuhumas at the moment, it's usually a safe bet. This way. Yeah, Steph's got their tracks coming this side. It's usually a safe bet to check around Gowrie Cutline somewhere, one of the drainage systems, the river systems there. Now, we're still missing one set of Nkuhuma cubs. We still haven't seen them for a really, really long time. We had them in the drainage system around Buffleshook Dam, and then she moved them. Herbert found the den site on Gowrie Cutline, but we haven't seen them since. We haven't been able to get a vehicle in there. We've just chosen not to try and do any ecological damage to try and see those cubs. So we're still missing three that we have yet to be acquainted with, but we're getting very, very close to the time period when we should be seeing them. I'm so busy strolling. Oh, Steph's on his mission again. Not checking for tracks, which I should be. Well, at least we've narrowed down where they would have been. I think they're going to come out at Gowrie Cutline, it's my suspicion. I think it might be worth having a quick squiz before the end of our walk on this sunrise safari. At the same time, checking very carefully, because there's lots and lots of buffalo in this area. But while we do some tracking and look for other wonderful things to show you, let's go over to Brent for an update on how his morning is going.
So exciting! Now I've just had a chat with yours. Now we're not sure whether it's Kutula, the female, or Kutula. So we're going to have to do a bit more research. So I'm going to send the photos up to the guys in the north, my friends who work in the Manuleti, see if they recognize her, pop it on the Sabi Sands group, see if anyone else recognizes her. But very exciting. If it's not Ukutula, it's definitely not a female we know. Now, that's very exciting from the leopard point of view. And of course, how wonderful, elephants with gems on World Elephant Day. So Brian and I have just been discussing. Lions have a day, elephants have a day. I'm quite sure quite a few other species have a day. So we've decided we are going to make our own day. It is called the Killer Bees Day, and it shall be on the 28th of August, and there will be much shenanigans and much fun to do with the killer bees. And there will be multiple challenges for all of you to partake in on Killer Bee Day, but more about that later. So just remember, jot down the 28th of August on your calendars. It's Killer Bee Day. I think it should be a public holiday. What do you think, Brian? We think it should be a public holiday. The killer bees! So we're going to definitely make that the most fun. So well done to Christy and Barbara, who got the Magnificent Seven Elephant Challenge correct. Now, I forgot. I'm trying to remember the exact lengths and weights. The longest tusk was Shaul, yes, it was Shaul, and in meters, 3.17 meters, 10.4 feet, one tusk, the other tusk, 3 meters, 9.4 feet. Isn't that incredible? Actually, let's just think. Let's find a long, straightish. Oh, no, let's do it on the road. But then the heaviest tusk was 70 kilograms. 154 pounds, and the other tusk was 134 pounds, I can't remember, 60 kilograms, and they belong to Jowl. Now, let's just think about this. So, those elephant tusks, we'll do the length, it's a bit difficult to do the weight. Let's think. Well, the heaviest elephant tusk is heavier than James. That's the best way I can describe it. But now, from a length point of view, let's have a look. How's this, Brian? Am I good here?
A little bit further.
Okay. So, we'll start on the side of the road. And it is 3.17 meters. So, there's one, two, three, and a bit. So, as wide as this road is, was the longest elephant tusk. How incredible that is. Now, actually, let's just think. I wonder how long our little cars are. So, if we start at the bull bar here, we go, one, two, three. It was longer than our car. How incredible is that? An elephant tusk that was longer than the vehicle. And that belonged to Shao. And the heaviest again was Zhao. Now, imagine carrying 150 pounds on your face. That must have been an incredible, incredible weight to have to carry around. A magnificent beast. Now, I'm not quite sure who's the biggest elephant at the moment. I know there's a couple up in the north of the Kruger. But we'll have to do some research on that and find out. A friend of my dad is actually probably one of the most famous elephant researchers ever, Dr. Ian White, and was in the Kruger and with those elephants for many, many, many years. And he's actually got an elephant tusker named after him, and so does his wife, the longest female elephant tusk in the Kruger. But speaking of elephants and tusks, not quite the 3.17 meters of Shawul, but it does have tusks indeed, with James.
It certainly isn't 3.1 meters, everybody, but it is an elephant with tusks, as you can see. Very beautiful cow, and she's come closer and closer. This is not the same one we were looking at when we last saw you. He's moved off into the bush slightly. And she's now kind of getting closer and closer and sampling this very large tree that has managed to escape the attentions of the elephants until this point. Oh dear. Right, well, that's that then. That was not very nice of her, I feel. Isn't that amazing? The strength involved in what she just did there is astonishing. Hello, Moinadeen in India. We've had a really nice array of people talking to us today. Moinadeen, you say, how long can an elephant survive without water and food? With water, probably about a maximum of maybe 2 weeks, but that would be a long time, I'd say. It would be a very long time. Food, I think you'll find probably maybe 3 weeks before they'd starve to death. But it's not a long time. Now this tree, that tree there, you can see is not, it hasn't completely escaped elephant attention in its history. That's why it's multi-stemmed like that. It doesn't just have one trunk, it has many. But it's been a while since it was mangled. That is probably about to change. That's quite nice to see, isn't it? Mum and youngster. Now I hope she doesn't break another bit off. I think they actually prefer the roots if they can get at them. All right, quickly let's go across to Brent. He's got something smaller and equally grey to show you.
So since we can't find any elephants, we have to go with another tusked grey beast, the little wart pigs. Hello, warthogs. And there's one female there who's actually got quite a nice set of tusks. She's just disappeared behind a little bush. And she's about to pop out there. She is. You can see her bottom. And we can see that glistening ivory through the trees there. So the elephants are not the only tusked animals in the bush. We have warthog tusks. We have hippopotamus tusks. And I think that's about where it ends. But as those little piglets disappear into the monkey orange thicket, let's go back to some much larger tusked creatures with James.
We haven't moved, but she has, everyone. She's gone across the road. She's now sampling looks like a red bush willow, as opposed to the large or the variable bush willow she was trying to mangle earlier on. Her youngster, however, is in exactly the same place as he was, or she was. Over there. It's so nice sitting here in the sun with these elephants now. Just about warmed up, haven't you, Eggsy?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. There we go. It's going to keep up with Mum, walking slightly faster as she gets, or she or he gets into the open. You see that? It's a little bit nervous. And now Russell in Australia, a nice one from you. I'm just going to move slightly so that Eggsy doesn't have to keep avoiding these signs next to which we parked. Russell, you say, why do elephants have no hair on them? Is there any advantage to this? Is there any real reason? Well, the advantage is that A, it's not expensive for them to maintain hair, like it's expensive for us to maintain hair. But the other reason, Russell, from Cheetah Plains, I think probably late for an aeroplane. Russell, the other reason is that they have what we know, what we call a very high surface area to body mass ratio, which means that they don't get cold, basically. And they don't get cold very easily, and they don't get hot very easily, which means that they don't need the same kind of insulation that an animal such as a bushveld gerbil would need, for example. And so although, yes, they do get a little bit cold, the bigger you are, the slower you will get cold. And so they don't have the same need to maintain a pelt of fur like so many animals are. And you'll find the bigger the animals are out here, the thinner their fur gets. And in some cases, like with the rhino and elephant and hippo, they don't have fur at all. But that's why. Very good question. Hello, Emmy. You want to know in English what the groups of elephants are called? Is it just called a group? No, it's called a herd, Emmy. Emmy, you know, there are lots of fanciful sort of collective nouns that people use for animals, but largely, biologically speaking, you would just use the term herd for any herbivore that doesn't that lives in a group. So it'd be a herd of impala, a herd of zebra, a herd of giraffe, and then of course you can use those rather fun words like dazzle of zebra or journey of giraffe or that sort of thing. But the elephants don't have their own one; they're just a herd. I've no doubt if you Google something like that, they'll come up with something that belongs to elephants. In fact, I have a book right here I can check. But no, as a biologist, you'd say a herd of elephants. But I bet you somebody's come up with something. I've got a whole table of them here in this book. Collective mammal names. Elephant, a parade, it says. A parade of elephants. There we are. So that would be the fun sort of word to use, I guess. But no, herd would be correct. Harate. One more car coming from the far west. East, sorry. So it's going to pass in front of us. Just to warn you. Hello, Anne. You're wondering about the bulls that lead the herds, and bulls don't lead herds at all. The bulls are not even part of the herd, actually. They are independent of the herd. The bull is, at least the herd, is led by a matriarch, which is the oldest female normally. That said, you want to know the big bulls, when they're older, recognize their mothers. I believe they do. I think these elephants are extremely good at recognizing their kith and kin. I don't know if it's by sight or smell or perhaps some other means, but yes, I do think that they recognize each other. But remember that any son that this cow you're watching now has will leave the herd and will not live in the herd once it's older, and will never join another herd. So they can, they live kind of on their own, and sometimes in groups of bulls. So there are two matriarchal societies out here, the elephants and the hyenas. We're really lucky we've had this sighting, everyone. We saw them some way away. Okay, we're going to move on, head back towards Juma. I can smell the gentle smoke of bacon coming off the pan. Let us head back across to Jamie and get an update from her, and I'll see you back at home.
Much like James, we are smelling, actually, we are really smelling this. Poor Gendre, sorry Gendre, I walked him straight underneath a tree. We are definitely smelling the smell of Amanda's cooking, which I have to confess I've been thinking about for the last 3 hours. I'm very excited for breakfast. However, our tracking was not in vain at all. We now have a really, there's a lion track there, by the way. We now have a really, really good place to start in terms of our afternoon sunset safari. Give us an opportunity to go and search. I think that Gowrie cutline drainage system will be a very good place to start to find those lions. And you'll have to join us in a few hours to see whether or not we manage to find them. For now, we are heading for home to see what else we can find. I'm going to pick my way through here. Actually been a really, really lovely morning. Beautiful temperature, as you can see. Jackets are off now. It's the interesting thing. Beautiful temperature, as you can see. Jackets are off now. It's the interesting thing about going walking in the morning is that you start off freezing and you warm up very, very rapidly. And I think as we start to head for home, it's time to say farewell to you all. So a big thank you to Gendre, and a well done, of course, for his avoidance of trees, branches, and showing you what for me was the highlight of the morning, which was that baboon spider. Thank you, Steph. You found another twig to hide behind. Def, that's almost as good as the first one. And a big thank you to all of you joining us. I hope you had a lovely morning spent on the back of the vehicles and out on bushwalk, and we'll catch you this afternoon for the sunset safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
Oh, we've just stumbled upon some more lion tracks. In the last few minutes, we're just going to stumble here. Unfortunately, we couldn't find any elephants for World Elephant Day, but we shall indeedy, hopefully, find some on the sunset safari. But very exciting, that new leopard, whose name is yet to be discovered. And hopefully I'll have an update for you come sunset safari about who she is. But it is very exciting to see a new leopard. I think it takes my leopard total of individual leopards since I've been at Safari Live and Wild Earth about 22 or 23. I'm going to have to do some counting. So incredible that in this area I've seen 22 different individual leopards, and very exciting. Hello Aqua. Aqua is wondering, how does this new female influence our current population of leopardesses? Aqua, only time will tell. Maybe she's just doing a little foray and she'll scuttle back to the north. So it's very difficult to say right now. If she stays around, then we can start speculating. But for now, it could be just as like Shiluva 2013 or Tsakani, in and out, had a quick look, decided it there was too many other females around, so let's get out of Dodge. But we will find out if we start seeing her more and more often. Well, it is very exciting to see a new leopard. I know I've probably said exciting far too many times in the last 2 minutes, but to use exciting, two more times, another exciting prospect is the Killer Bee Day, the 28th of August. Brian and I have been planning lots of fun shenanigans to play on the Killer Bee Day, so we will be looking for all animals beginning with a B. Oh, I just missed that. Apparently August the 28th is National Bow Tie Day. Brian, it begins with a B. I think we're going to have to get some bow ties. For killer bees will wear bow ties on the 28th. So we're going to look for all animals beginning with B, and we're going to do many birds. But if you guys have any suggestions about what we should celebrate on the Killer Bees Day, what fun things we can do on both the sunrise and sunset safari, let us know and pop those emails through to Final Control, who will forward them on to us, and questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So our idea so far is we're going to do birds, all animals beginning with B. What was the other one, Brian? Ah, no, that one is to be revealed. That will be revealed close to the time. So it will be celebrating all things B, and specifically B squared. Okay, so we are going to meander on back towards breakfast, and that begins with a B, so it's a wonderful thing. And we're just going to start prepping you for Killer Bee Day with lots of bee words. And while we do that and think of what other fun things we can do on the 28th of August, apart from wearing a bow tie on Game Drive, let's go back to James so he can bid you adieu, and we'll see you on the Sunset Safari. Bye, Thumb!
Roy from Simbambili has just stopped in front of us there. Not from Simbambili, from Arethusa. And, sorry, it's not Roy, it's Sipor, sorry. And he's looking in here. What's he got? Can you see anything? Hey? Baboons. Ah, baboons. I thought maybe it was going to be Karula. But it isn't. It's a baboon. Well spotted, Eggsy. That's very good. That is the Chacma baboon, everybody. Famous primate of this part of the world. Going to reverse a bit before we get run down like mangy hounds. You still see them. I would love to stop, Eggsy, but we're being chased. And they're running also, yes. We don't often see them, everyone, and I think that's largely a function of the lack of very tall trees that we have along drainage line areas. Ooh, there are quite a few of them here. I'll try and stop here and not be run down. But they are well to the south of us. Very nice, Eggsy. Well done. That is the famous Chacma baboon. They'll be struggling, but very joyful. I bet you we'll find them at some stage in that great big jackalberry tree, eating away at those ripe fruits. I might not even wait for them to be ripe. Somebody asked a very valid question the other day, whether we might find them in the same tree as we would find monkeys. And I said, no, it's highly unlikely, because a baboon, if it can catch a small monkey, will eat it. They are very omnivorous. Bit like us, and they've got massive, massive canines. Very good. Not really sure where to go now. I think we're going to have to wait here for a little bit. Can you see any more of them, Eggsy? Let's go back a little bit. Judy H, you say elephants on Elephants Day. World Elephant Day and the Big Cat Trifecta. We did have a very big Cat Trifecta, and you're very grateful for it. Well, we're just as grateful, Judy H. It has been an incredible day. Oh, they're now behind us on the road. Hang on a sec. We'll get a last view of them before we say goodbye to you. There they are. Oh, they're coming into Joom, everybody. Yeah. All right, that's going to be it from us today. Like Judy H. said, a wonderful day of elephants, World Elephant Day. I hope you have a good World Elephant Day wherever you happen to be. Thank you, Eggy, for your efforts today. Well done, good job. Thanks to Brent and Jamie as well. And the final control, we'll see you later today at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Bye-bye.